Good evening. Today I want to talk about, I'm going to do something that's going to be a little, as they say, ghetto, you know, because I have a laser printer here that is black and white, and I wanted to show you some images of what's part of the history of my country of origin, and some of the lessons that could be learned from what has happened in our history, and that people should be making notes on how that could be something to learn from. You know, always have to be learning. So what is there to be learned from our country and what we have put up with for such a long time, for our lack of knowledge, pretty much, you know. We have no one to blame but ourselves, really, for the spot in which we are right now. I'm not there, you know. I live in the United States, but I'm here because of what has happened in my country of origin, and the problem's still going on, you know. When it keeps happening. You know, so when are we going to break free from this curse? Okay, so here's the first image that I wanted to show you. That is Sandino, General Sandino. He fought the Americans when they occupied the country from around the 1927 to 1933. I'm not exactly sure about those numbers, but you know, he was there. He fought the occupation, and so they, you know, a lot of people. He started very small and then grew to important numbers to, you know, in relation to the size of our country. When I left the country, we were like only like 2 million and some people, so we're, you know, it's a very small country. So it's still small. I think a little over 5 million now, you know. So but okay, whatever. So he was he fought the Americans, and at first he was unsuccessful a couple of campaigns because he was trying to, you know, face him straight on, you know, like an army would do. But you know, you don't fight against an army with just a few soldiers and win, you know. And so he started fighting another way, guerrilla warfare. He was hiding, and you know, and actually I heard that the Vietnamese learned something from him. I don't know whether it was just because they just repeated what he did, but that's pretty much what he was doing. He was fighting, you know, guerrilla warfare. So the thing is that the Americans left the country, and but they were pissed at Sandino because I guess Sandino really caused them some severe problems there, you know. So they hated his guts, so they left this other this Nicaraguan that was in the army, of a Nicaraguan army that they created, And he could speak fluent English, and they made him. I think there was like a coup or something, and they put him in power pretty much. Sorry. And so he started making peace treaties with Sandino, because he said, he told them, look, the Americans are out, so well, there's no reason to fight now. So Sandino, I guess, agreed, you know, with him. And here's the second picture I wanted to show you, you know, of Sandino next to Somoza, you know, and they're hugging, you know. So Somoza invited him to a party, you know, and then this is Somoza, yeah, inviting him to a party, and then they ambushed him and his men, and they killed him, you know. So he betrayed Sandino big time. There was actually a comment that President Roosevelt made about Somoza for doing this, I guess, you know. It says, he, referring to Anastasio Somoza, may be a son of a bitch, but he is our son of a bitch. Franklin D. Roosevelt. So, here he is, Somoza with Roosevelt and Washington. But, you know, things happen, and a lot of people were pissed, I guess, because of what this guy did in the country. And because he was like, you know, a puppet of the Americans. So there was this poet in Nicaragua. We have a lot of people. The poetry in Nicaragua is really big, you know, because we have like one of the best poets ever in the Spanish. And so I guess there's it's part of our culture. We love poetry. I write poetry myself, so I might not be accomplished poet, but I am a poet at heart, you know. So. And so we had this poet who took matters into his own hands. His name was Rigoberto López Pérez. And that was Somoza. And they had a party for re-election, something like that. So Rigoberto went and killed him. He got a gun, fired 5 bullets at him. They immediately shot him down. Also, he nailed 4 bullets into Somoza, and he fired 5. So he got the reverse. He got shot 54 times. He got killed on the spot. Somoza still survived and went to Panama, but died the next, like a little, like eight days later. The problem is, when you do a sacrifice like that, you don't understand that there's, you know, the main man is not just him. There's a bunch of people behind him. So you're not gonna solve the problem with just killing one person. and sacrificing your life with that. The change has to be, like Mark Passio says all the time, in the aggregate, you know. So we have to start creating consciousness in the population, so that we start in the aggregate making a change for everyone. So what happened is that they put this guy, which was his son, Somoza's son, in power, Luis Somoza. They say it wasn't that bad, actually, that this guy, I don't know exactly, because, you know, they were pretty mean, all of them, I think. They say that he was the best of all of them. You know, so, and then after this guy left power, we got, they had like fake, you know, puppets for some time. But they were always behind it. It's like, they had puppets just to like make it sound like they weren't always in control. They were always in control. From when the first Somoza took over to the last. This was the last. So he was right after the other one that I showed you before. This is Anastasio Somoza Divine. Had he not been overthrown, he would have left this other guy in power, which was his son, you know. This one, of course. So these guys were pretty inclined to the military. They were school in West Point, and you know, they love all that, you know, kind of stuff. That's the Somoza's National Guard. They were pretty scary people, you know. They were trained to like distance themselves from the people. They saw themselves as a different entity, you know, like everybody's like you know, just a subject that's and then they are, you know, the agents of the state. So they felt like, and usually they look for stupid, ignorant people, you know, to do this, because it's like they give them power, you know, they put them in a uniform and a nice machine gun, and they felt like they owned the world. But the people resisted, you know. Hardly any weapons, you know, in the beginning. But the people resisted. That's a woman right there. You know, there were many women fighting. Everybody, young kids. They had a lot. Somoza was like a freak, you know. He liked, like I said, his military. The people fought, you know, with barely nothing. I know, it's ghetto. So they, you know, when the Sandinista Front were a leftist group, and they were being trained and everything, by leftist groups, and they often travel to Cuba and all that. They adopted the name of Sandino, but they had really nothing to do with him. And I think he would have killed them all. He had to be alive, because they didn't represent him. He will be fighting now against them, because he was a better person, absolutely, you know. So the Sandinistas said they weren't communists and all that, and even though nobody really knew what communism was, so we started learning that the hard way, you know, just like Venezuela is now. So this was Ortega, the actual president now in Nicaragua in 2018, and there he is with Castro in the 70s. So what happened is that, okay, so most of the third one, he was overthrown in 1979. A group of people took, you know, by the people, they was overthrown by the people backing up this group, okay? And so what happened is that there was a group of people that took power, you know, it's a group of people, 12 people, I think. They started from different areas. And then they elected one president. We had a lot of people. We started noticing things that weren't right away. You know, like, okay, freedom wasn't really, you know, we didn't know what freedom was. So nobody knows really what freedom is. Everybody's just like, so we're free now, okay? No, you're not free. You're not yourself. You just change things for your advantage. But, you know, that the people is not really free. Nobody really knows, because we haven't experienced it in this world, really. So you have to start studying. You have to start learning. Why? What is this? You know, what makes us free, really? You know, so... they passed a law this year, and I'm talking now, today is the December 28th, let me see, 29 now, because it's past midnight of 2018, and they passed a law, and the people protested. As soon as they protested, they got attacked by the government, you know? So, what I was saying before is that, okay, 1984, Daniel Ortega was elected, but the government became unsustainable, because there was the war between the Sandinistas and the Contras and all that. So he had to go into elections. So he transferred power to a lady, Violeta Barrios de Chamorro, and she was the president for a period. And then they elected another guy, Alemán, who was Star Steely. So crooked guy, and then another one, Bolaños, who was like, they were always controlling from beneath, you know, from underneath government. This, like, they always had, like, a, you know, since they went into went into elections and all that, they became a political party, and they were always behind everything. They were controlling a lot of things from beneath, you know, the face of power. So, and after Bolaños' period, he Ortega came back to power. So he had a deal with Venezuela with oil and all that. So, you know, I don't know whether that's the reason why he was elected, because there was a problem with gasoline at the moment, and, you know, power outages. Sorry. And it could be that people were like, okay, so he's gonna be in bed with Venezuela, which has oil, so we need some oil here. And that's what attracted the, you know, the people to vote for him the first time. The second time, he pretty much they say he stole the elections. You know, once he was in power, he was easy for him to steal the elections. So in April of this year, they had that law passed, you know, that which way he had bankrupted the Social Security money. And then they went out and protested. Since there were other presidents before him, he had promoted the culture of protesting. But what the people didn't know is that they couldn't protest against him. So as soon as they started protesting, they started repressing everybody. So, you know, harassing them, and then started beating them and killing whoever was protesting. Now they made a law that makes whoever's protesting like terrorists. Of course, they cost them terror because they want to stay in power, and it's terrorizing for them to lose power. And they had groups like this, you know, I don't know if you can tell, but people, you know, cover their faces, and they go around terrorizing the people and the police also. And, you know, so we went back to what we started with. So it's unfortunate, but it's in a small scale in Nicaragua, but at some point this could be happening around the world. The people in Nicaragua don't have weapons. If the people have weapons now, we wouldn't have this problem now, because I know that the people have the guts to confront the government, but they haven't because they don't have weapons. The first thing that Sandinistas did after they took overthrew Somoza was take all the weapons from everybody. So now the people's on arm, you know, and it has been peaceful for some time, and now it's just, you know, hell, because these people are just controlling everything. The people cannot even protest anymore. The TV channels that were saying bad things about got robbed, pretty much. They put them out of, you know. They even arrested some reporters. So it's all when is this gonna stop? If we don't learn that we don't really need these people. We don't need an army. We don't need police. Costa Rica doesn't have an army. It's been 70 years since they don't have an army. So, it's such a small country. My country. And we haven't learned yet. Hopefully. It looks like now they could be intervening militarily because all the countries just can't deny what's going on, and they have to look good for their own governments, you know, because you know, how is it that this horrible situation is happening in Nicaragua and you don't do anything about it? So at some point they're gonna have to step in. Just, it's not so much to take care about it, you know, but that they have to look good. They have to look like they care, you know. They go for justice and all that. It's like the justice system here, the criminal justice system here. They have to pretend that they're doing the right thing, even though we all know it's all made believe. It's all created to control everybody, to have people obeying laws that are not fair, you know, and they work against us, but we don't see it because we were born and, you know, raised to believe that it's okay. But it's not okay if you really study what's going on, you know, and how it is, and if you're objective enough to understand that this is all made to keep us in a cage, you know, in the hamster wheel. We're not moving forward in progress unless we break out of this cage. So and it's a big problem because we're gonna inherit this world to our kids, and you know, there's only gonna be an elite group, you know, really living life instead of all humanity enjoying life, you know, living life. But it could happen if we all help each other understand, you know, the plot of, you know, what they have going against all humanity. So we'll see where this goes. Hopefully the internet starts waking people up, and you know, it's like people, we have to share this information to each other, because if not, we're doomed. All right, and some people don't care and don't listen, you know, but well, all we can do is try. You know, the harder the better. I'm gonna start learning a little more to see how I can do this in a better fashion, a better way. Like you see, it's a little ghetto. But all I could do is just try to share this information that I've learned from others. And I keep learning, because I don't claim to know at all. But yeah, I know enough to know that we're in trouble here, you know. And the lesson in Nicaragua is that the country, the people have tried to be free, but if they keep us busy and not, we don't start learning the philosophy of how is it that we're gonna become free, you know, because we have to break free from all this tradition that we have. Alright, it's from, you know, with being transferred, that the educational system is a big part of the problem, because they're not teaching people the right thing. They're just teaching you things that are Not important. You could learn, and now it's obsolete. That education is actually obsolete, because right now you just look at pick up your phone and learn some things, that you have to spend all those years, away from your children in that cage, and instead of them learning from you and learn, if you learn yourself, that things that really matter. My son once told me, "Yeah, how come you never told me about the horror of 9/11?" And I had to tell him, "Hey, what did they tell you?" And I had to, make some things clear to him. And he was like, "Wow, how come you never told me that?" Because sometimes we assume that they know what we know, and they don't know what we know. We have to teach them. And but he's pretty smart. He's a really sweet kid, but he's smart. He's learning. He knows. He stays quiet in school, but he knows too much already. they would like him not to know, it's like, but he has to put up with that, because that's the way the school system is, He gets surprised. He tells me about it when somebody breaks, the cage a little bit and then says something that it wasn't supposed to. He tells me, "No, somebody stood up and said this," and like, Sometimes I guess the kids are learning little by little with the internet, and they just keep quiet because they know it's not, gonna probably make a change now, but they're growing in a different environment than what we grew up in, and hopefully that's something that's gonna create a change in the future, hopefully. So that's all I wanted to say for now. I think I took a little too long, but I did another video. I didn't like it so much, and I'll hopefully start improving on this. Okay, so God bless you. Happy New Year 2019. Good night. Bye.